Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of 1998 Represent. Today, this episode, we're taking a look at the Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. This is another music album video. So this album, it's the solo debut of Lauryn Hill. She was in the Fugees. They released some albums before this, but this is her solo debut album. It's released August 25th, 1998, and it's also, amazingly, the only studio album she's done. I think there's like a live album, like an MTV Unplugged a few years later, and like a couple like compilation albums, but this is the only studio album that she's done. I'm hoping we get more from her. I don't know if we will, but also this album is basically perfect, and it's kind of like maybe she felt like that she wanted to say everything she wanted to say in this album, and maybe there's no need for another album, you know, like kind of like go out on top kind of thing. So again, only studio album. The whole kind of over like theme throughout the album is at the end of certain songs, the intro has basically a teacher doing like a roll call in a class. He lists off all the students and they're like here or present or whatever, and he gets to Lauryn Hill's name. And she doesn't respond. He says her name like a total of three times, and then it goes right into the first track. And at the beginning, or I think it's at the end of some of the songs, there is kind of these interstitial bits with that teacher again talking about the overall theme of the like lessons that the teacher is teaching. It's about love. So there's all those like little school bits. This is, I guess, technically a hip-hop album, but saying that kind of does it a huge disservice because it has so many different genres in it. It's, you know, you have, let's see what genres, you have hip-hop, you have R&B, you have soul, there's like neo-soul, I guess, is one of the other genres that it follows. And it's not just song to song where the genres are, like she'll be, you know, like doing like an R&B part during one song and seamlessly transition it into like a hip-hop bit, and then like there's a song called doo-wop, that thing, it'll be starting off like with like a doo-wop slash Motown kind of style like singing, and then goes right into hip-hop and right back to the doo-wop bit. It's quite amazing. So multiple genres. Let's see here. The lyrics basically touch on her issues with her with the Fugees at the time, and then also her pregnancy, where she became pregnant before making this album. And there's a song called To Zion, which is about, I guess, people in her life were telling her, like, one of the lyrics is, people are like, be smart, use your head. She's like, use your head. And she's like, I instead chose to use my heart or follow my heart or something like that. And that's one of the more beautiful songs on the album, because she ended up, like, having this child, Zion is the name of her son, or at least her first child, and like a lot of the songs relate to kind of like her pregnancy and what have you. This album sold, looks like, 422,000 copies in its first week, and at the time that had broke a record for a female artist. So 422,000 copies in the first week. Was nominated for 10 Grammys, and it won 5 of those 10. Out of the 5 that it won, I have my little notes here. It's a Best New Artist, Best R&B Song, Best Female R&B Performance, Best R&B Album, and Album of the Year on top of it. And that was the first time a hip-hop album had won won Album of the Year at the Grammys. We're just going to go take a look at the track listing here. Let me just pull that up. All right, here we are. So it's 16 songs, and it goes for about an hour and 17 minutes. So it's definitely on, like, kind of on the longer side, but it's basically a perfect album. First song is the intro. It's only 47 seconds long, and that's the thing I was talking about earlier, where the school teacher is kind of just doing the roll call. There's track 2 is Lost Ones. There is then X Factor is track 3. To Zion is the song I mentioned earlier, where she's talking about kind of her pregnancy, and then people telling her to, you know, follow her, be smart, you know, like, don't throw away her career, that kind of thing. So that's To Zion. That also features Carlos Santana. Track 5 is Doo-Wop, That Thing. That's number 5. Number 6 is Superstar. In track 7, we have Final Hour. Track 8 is When It Hurts So Bad. Track number 9 is I Used to Love Him, and that features Mary J. Blige as well. 10 is Forgive Them, Father. 11 is Every Ghetto, Every City. 12 is Nothing Even Matters, that features D'Angelo. Track 13 is Everything is Everything. 14 is The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. And I think this one actually has, like, I really like it when the album actually has, like, record scratches on it. And what I mean by record scratches, it sounds like the song is playing on an old vinyl, and you kind of get, like, a little bit of, like, static and poppy and that kind of thing. So that was The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. That's track 14. Track 15 is Can't Take My Eyes Off of You, which is, I guess, apparently a hidden track. And then track 16 is Tell Him, which is also a hidden track. There's just, we did the track, let's see, there's just a ton of accolades for this album. Just a few, we'd be here all day if I listed off all of them. But for example, About.com listed it as the 100 greatest, in its list of 100 greatest hip-hop albums. That was in 2008. It was song number 43. They also listed it as the best rap albums of 1998. That list was published in 2008, and that actually made it to number one. The Associated Press has it as the 10 best albums of the 90s. That was listed or published in 1999. We go to Blender. They have it listed at 500 CDs You Must Own Before You Die. That was in 2003. They also listed it as the 100 greatest American albums of all time. It was listed at 75. That came out in 2002. Some more we have Entertainment Weekly. 100 best albums from 1983 to 2008. That list came out in 2008, and it made it to number 2 on that list. And another one from Entertainment Weekly is 30 essential albums from the last 30 years, and that was in 2020. I don't think that was done in any particular order because there was no ranking on that one. NPR has it listed at the 150 greatest albums made by women. That was in 2017, and that was ranked at number 2. NPR also has Turning the Tables, the 150 Greatest Albums Made by Women as Chosen by You. That came out the year before. It was ranked at track number 3. So that was more like a fan choice kind of thing, or like People's Choice Award kind of thing like that. Pitchfork had it listed at the 100 Best Albums of the 1990s. That's from 2022, and it made it to number 2 on that list. And then we'll do Rolling Stone, 50 Essential Female Albums. It was at 32. That came out in 2002. 500 Greatest Albums of All Time, 2020, that was at track number, entry number 10. And the Essential Recordings of the 90s, that came out, that was listed in 1999, and that was more just a list. There was no, wasn't done in any particular order. Speaking of Rolling Stone, they also listed it on their top 200 hip-hop albums of all time list. It made it at number 10, and the excerpt from that is, 10 is this album. Looking to express herself outside the hugely successful Fugees, 23-year-old Lauryn Hill came through with a feminist hip-hop soul masterpiece on her 1998 debut. The opening 1-2 punch still stuns the, anthemic, Lost Ones, moves into brutal breakup ballad, X Factor, the smash hit, Doo-Wop, That Thing is sandwiched between To Zion, an ode to her first child, and Superstar, a demand for more inspirational mass culture. At 77 minutes long, Miseducation spills over with brilliant, at times contradictory insights, thrilling melodies, and plenty of moralizing. A righteous blockbuster that redefined every genre it touched. So there's that. That was just based on my notes and the kind of like the research I was doing in this album. I first heard this album, I want to say it was in maybe like November or December of this year, of 1998. I had a study hall kind of class. I don't know if it was a study hall. I think it was just like, basically we were just sitting around in this one class talking about music. It may have been a humanities class, but we were just talking about albums. We were talking about, I had mentioned Beat the Beastie Boys, Hello Nasty, and somebody had mentioned this album, and we were able to, I think we had a CD player in this room, because it was, like, part of the music, we weren't in, like, the, like, orchestra area of the school, but it was definitely, like, where they had, like, did music practice and what have you, So it wasn't like at in the auditorium or anything like that. But they had a CD player, and we played some of this. We played some of the Beastie Boys album that I brought. And then later that week, I went to a Sam Goody and picked it up on CD. I don't have it on vinyl yet. It's definitely something I would want to add to my collection on vinyl. It's just a masterpiece of an album. Like, and it's kind of not surprising that she hasn't gone back and done another one, because, like I said earlier, it's like, why? Like, you're. Maybe she knows she's never going to top this, and it would be a very tall order to even attempt that. But again, it's one of the greatest albums ever made, one of the greatest albums of 1998 for sure, one of the greatest hip-hop albums as well. If you have never heard this album, I would highly recommend getting on, streaming it, buying a digital album, even like buying like a physical like CD or vinyl of it if it's available, because it's basically perfect. It's like I said, it's hip hop, but calling it a hip hop album kind of does that a disservice, just because, like, there's, like I said, there's doo wop on the album, there's soul, R&B. It covers like so many genres. To just call it one genre kind of doesn't really do it justice. So, highly recommend that you check this album out. I'm probably, like I said, I'm going to maybe try to grab this on vinyl at some point if I see it. Don't know if it's available, but I'm going to try to get it. And it's like one of the best albums of all time. I'll probably later in the year probably have to fe or feature this album again on my 52 Essential Album series as well, because this is definitely going to be on that list. So definitely check it out. It's incredible. And that's going to do it for this episode. We'll be back. I think our next episode is going to be A Night at the Roxbury. Just an amazing, funny comedy from late from the fall of 1998, based on the SNL skit by Chris Kattan and Will Ferrell. We'll be covering that next. Obviously, we'll be covering more stuff later through the year, more video games, more music, movies, so on. That's going to do for now. Remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe. Thanks again for watching. Take care and have a good one. See ya.